How many of you are registered for the draft? Women already registered, I didn't know that. But actually, the Secretary of the Army said today they're going to start registering women as well, or he thinks they may have to. But my question is, why do you think the government registers you at all for a draft? If you don't have a draft, they've already got your Social Security number. Why do they want you to register? I'm thinking maybe they want you to admit your submission. Admit that you will go wherever, whenever they tell you. But you know what? You do get a choice. You get a choice on who you elect to run the country, on whether or not you'll go to war or not. This is the issue of the day right now, and it's becoming more and more profound and more imminent. Why is it an issue? Because you have virtually every other presidential candidate saying, we must have a no-fly zone. We must tell Russia they cannot fly over Syria or Iraq. What do you think that means? Right now, Russia's already flying over Syria and Iraq. Why? Because Syria invited them. Iraq invited them. So if you announce, as Carly Fiorina has, as Hillary Clinton has, as Rubio and several of the others have, that we're going to enforce a no-fly zone over an area where people are already flying, what do you think that means? That means we're going to shoot down Russian fighters. Well, we spent 70 years trying to avoid an altercation with Russia, trying to avoid an altercation with another superpower that has nuclear weapons. Who are the people that tried to avoid war? Ronald Reagan. Even though he's not always depicted this way by the liberal media, Ronald Reagan didn't shut down communications. He actually opened communications with the Russians. So we have people on the Republican stage now saying, we should not talk to Putin. Well, that's a recipe for disaster. We're going to all be flying our jets in about a 100-square-mile area, and we're not going to have a discussion with Putin? That's a recipe for disaster. How many have read All Quiet on the Western Front? Still people reading it. You remember in there the headmaster encouraged them to go to war, and they were supposed to be excited to go to war. It was supposed to be so patriotic and such a great thing, World War I. People today still dispute why the hell they fought the war. Millions of people died. The Battle of the Somme, 7 million people died. For what? War's a terrible thing. Does that mean we should be defenseless and not defend our country? Absolutely not. But it means we shouldn't be eager or reckless or wanting for war. War should be the last resort, not the first resort. When war comes, you'll be the generation that fights it. And it may not be a volunteer army, it may well be subscription, conscription, it may well be a draft again. Every one of you, man and woman, may be sent, but you have a choice. You have a choice who your leaders will be. They ask us for weapons for the Islamic rebels that were fighting against Assad. And I ask them the question now, then, the same question I say now, I say, won't it be a great irony if the weapons we give to those rebels that were back a year later having to fight against their own weapons? That's what's going on now. You hear about ISIS in the news, but where did ISIS get its weapons? From us. From our allies Saudi Arabia. From our allies Qatar. ISIS has $1 billion worth of U.S. Humvees that got around there. U.S. Humvees. They pay their soldiers with $1 billion of U.S. cash they stole as well. They have anti-tank weapons that we gave to other Islamic rebels but were quickly snatched up by ISIS. You say, well, how did all these U.S. weapons wind up with them when we were giving them to the moderate rebels in Syria? Well, one CIA analyst put it this way. He said the only thing moderate about the rebels in Syria is their ability to fight. So we gave them these weapons, and they were ineffective, and they were immediately snatched up by ISIS. ISIS has our tanks. They've got our anti-tank weapons. I mean, it is completely insane. In the last presidential debate, they said, what will you do to defeat ISIS? And I said, well, maybe we ought to start with not arming them. Maybe we shouldn't fund them. The war over there is an utter and complete disaster, but there are evil people on both sides of it. Are you willing to go and fight Assad? Are you willing to fight to the death their death or your death, to fight against a dictator in Syria, but to fight for Islamic rebels who also hate us. ISIS obviously hates everyone, Christians, particularly infidels compared to them, or by their thinking. But are you willing to fight and die for that? Is there something over there that you can conceive of that's worth laying your life down for? You know, you have Hillary Clinton wanting to have a no-fly zone, and you have Republicans wanting to do the same thing. The same nonsense, the same bad planning, the same thing that drug us into the first Iraq war. Who voted for the first Iraq war? Hillary Clinton. Now, she later on backpedaled like everything else. Once she finds out something's unpopular, she flips to the other side. In Syria, we've said, well, we're going to fund and train these Syrian moderates. So we spent $250 million to train 60 of them. Over $4 million per fighter. And you know what we did? We sent them back into battle, five at a time. Who sends in an army of five people? They were captured in 10 minutes, stripped of their weapons by al-Nusra. Who is al-Nusra? It's another name for al-Qaeda. They're radical Islamists in Syria. And people say, well, why would we be fighting with al-Qaeda? And they tell us, oh, that's what we must do now. We must fight with al-Qaeda against ISIS. Because there are two variants of radical Islam, but we can live now with al-Qaeda. I'm like, weren't they the people who attacked us on 9/11? Now we're going to fight with them? And then later on, they're going to love us. We're going to have a big hug. We're going to do a big group hug afterwards, and al-Nusra's going to love us. No, they'll kill us when we turn around. Maybe there is no answer. There's another war going on in Yemen. In Yemen, you have these Houthi rebels, and Iran is supporting them. You have these other Sunni Muslims, and Saudi Arabia supporting them in Washington. Boom, boom, boom. The war drums. Everybody beats the drums and says, oh, we got to get involved in Yemen because Iran is in Yemen. And it's like, the Iranians are killing al-Qaeda. Maybe we should buy popcorn. You know? Maybe sometimes there isn't an answer, and maybe sometimes we just shouldn't be involved. Does that mean we retreat and sort of get behind our fortress America, or get behind our oceans and do nothing? No, I think we do need to be engaged, diplomatically engaged. And it's funny how people use these terms. Some people say, oh, you're talking about isolationism. No, I'm not. But in some ways, they're talking about diplomatic isolationism. Not talking to Putin is a form of isolationism, a form of diplomatic isolationism. But you will have a choice, and a lot of this is up to you. You're the ones who fight the war. So think long and hard about it, whether you're ready to volunteer to go to another Iraq war. Think long and hard about whether it would be good for America and whether you're up to the task and this is something you think we ought to do. Because your vote will make a difference.